so much.
Thank you, Todd. Thank you very much. Good to be here. In fact, it's great to be here. We're squeezing the stress balls a little early. We're going to pass these out a little bit earlier, later. But, you know, technology kind of does that to people, especially when they're a presenter. Todd came over and said, maybe you just have to do it from memory. And I was going to go talk to Todd outside. I said, you get your AV going because my memory's, you know, not what it used to be. Anybody grow up on the farm? We got a few farmers. Good, you're going to enjoy today. If you didn't grow up on the farm today, you're still going to enjoy today because you're going to learn what a farm's all about. Because we're going to do some stuff out of Farmer Abel. Farmers discovered something. He has discovered his clicker doesn't work again. There we go. The pigs are running the farm. That's what Farmer Abel grumbled to himself and even times bellowed out loud. The pigs are running the farm. This was the last thing any visitor might notice. After all, the pigs mostly laid in the shade in their pen. So how could the animals like that be running the farm? The only initiative they demonstrated was during feeding time. Then they sprang from their mud hole, oinked and squealed feverishly. Being fed by Farmer Abel was all that they were interested in. Just give them their slop, and they were happy. They were consumed by consuming. But their piggish behavior didn't remain with just them. No, this attitude, Farmer Abel believed, had begun to affect all the animals on the farm. Anybody been in an environment where one employee impacts the attitude in the rest of the organization? We've all seen it. Why a fable? Why do we want to do servant leadership through a fable? This goes back to my upbringing as a leader. Back in my mid-20s, I was going to work for a manufacturing company. Thought I knew everything. Young man, 25, I could solve the world. And someone gave me a book called The Goal. Anybody read The Goal? Oh, nobody. That was a story about an operation that wasn't performing. And the central office brought in someone to come in and turn it around and fix it. And what I loved about that story, and what I remember this day, was the day that leader got so frustrated in his turnaround efforts that he decided he needed to go spend some time alone. Back then, I didn't know it was thinking about your thinking. What I liked about this manager is the first place he stopped was the pizza place, got himself a pizza and a six-pack of beer, and went up on a mountaintop above his plant and started drinking beer and eating pizza going, what am I going to do? He had no idea what to do. Leaders sometimes don't know what to do. Farmer Abel sees things that's going on in his farm, and he doesn't know what to do quite yet. He doesn't know how quite to do. Clarice is one of the characters. We're going to talk about Clarice the cow, Harry the horse, Juanita the chicken. Did I lose anybody yet? Good. And Sparky the dog. Now, I have my favorites in the book, and I'll love them both. I love them all, but Sparky, we're going to talk about after lunch. He's kind of my favorite, because he's the most consistent performer you'll see when you're trying to change the culture of your company. It's Sparky the dog. Okay, we're going to fight this all day, aren't we? Nope. So let's talk about servant leadership before we get into Clarice. We talked last year what servant leadership was taking the leadership model and turn it upside down. What do you think when you hear someone talk about taking the leadership model and turning it upside down? What's the first thing that comes to your mind? Jump in here. You guys can participate. It's not working. What else? Shake up the norm. Do something different. Do you think it can really work if the CEO puts on a wristband and says, I'm second? Yeah. At Datron, we implemented servant leadership. I was a traditional power leader. So my wife says I could clear a conference room in about 3 minutes. And I was the only one talking. I was into power. So at Datron, what we do, and we defined our servant leadership as to inspire and equip those we influence. Now notice, we don't say those that report to us, because we influence others in the organization that don't report to us, right? Parents in the room, you influence your kids. Other parents influence your kids. Other kids influence your kids. They get influence from all different directions. So everyone influences someone. So inspire and equip those that we influence. We're watched all the time as leaders. You guys are watched all the time in your leadership roles, in your organizations, in your restaurants. People watch what you're going to say. They watch what you're going to do. They watch everything that you do when you're inside that building. They even watch what you don't do. They even watch what you don't say. Let's go talk about Clarice. Come on, Clarice, I know you're there. Now, Clarice is expected to do what on a farm? Anybody? Produce milk. That's why we have them, right? She looks at the pigs and says, they're not doing anything. So what happens to her performance? It goes down. And what do we do as leaders? Farmer Abel had a little book that he kept in his pocket of his bib overalls. He weighed each day's cow's milk every day, recorded it in his little book. He began to notice that Clarice wasn't producing. Clarice heard him muttering to himself, confounded cow, her numbers are down. What's wrong with her? What's wrong with her? When our performance is down, do we say, what's wrong with our employees? Or do we ask first, what's wrong with us? That's an interesting question. Because in a servant-led organization, we talk about ourselves first. Let's look at the behaviors of servant leadership. Well, we're going to offset it with the opposite behaviors that you learned yesterday from Stephen. Okay? So first, serve first. Opposite is disrespect. You don't serve. You basically don't care about people. Build trust. You withhold trust. You heard Stephen yesterday say, isn't our job as leaders to extend trust first? If we want to build trust with our organization, don't we have to take the first step? Stephen said, that's what we need to do as leaders yesterday. Live your values. You heard Stephen talk about, we assume expectations. Anybody remember the video he used for this? Two little girls, one behind that's going to catch the girl that's falling. Except they didn't talk. She didn't ask you which way you're going to fall. She assumed, and she fell the wrong way. Or in her mind, she fell the right way. Listen to understand. Stephen said this is the most difficult thing that we have to do as leaders when we want to build trust. Listen to understand. Now, when we don't do that, we all speak first. And he talked a little bit about the debate that's going on in our mind. We're always thinking about what we're going to say to what that person's saying to us. Anybody have a debate in their mind when they're talking to their spouse and something they don't agree with? You guys in the room, I know you do it, because I do it. All right? We're thinking about what we're going to say instead of listening to understand. Does the person you're listening to feel understood? And if the answer to that is no, then you need to listen some more. So listen to understand. Think about your thinking. Offset to that is we don't care. We're not accountable. We're not going to care about our responsibility. The one thing leaders can't give away is responsibility. We have a responsibility to our organizations to be great, to provide for them and their families. Anybody feel that they have a responsibility for the families of those that work in your organization? Because if they don't have a job because we didn't do our job, are you going to impact them financially? Absolutely. Absolutely. We didn't do our job, but we've got to let people go because we didn't do it. Add values to others. Pinocchio. I love Pinocchio. I worked for a company, big corporation in San Diego. Every quarter, we'd go off for 2 days. We'd spend 2 days figuring out how we're going to tell the corporate group how we're going to get better. We didn't spend 1 minute trying to figure out how we were going to get better. We spent 2 days figuring out how we're going to tell someone we're going to get better. How stupid is that? It's dumb. But we spin the lies. I love Pinocchio. Well, you know, I did. Just answer the question. Anybody just want to say that to someone in your life? Just answer the question for me. I think I say it about 15 or 20 times when I watch the news and see a politician. Just answer the question, please. Demonstrate courage. Or you can bury your head in the sand. Hope it goes away. Hope it goes away. I have things in my company, thank you very much, that I would just go in the back room, keep my fingers crossed, and hope somebody will pick up and take the ball. Anybody feel like that someday? Nobody? You guys are pretty good. You mean I'm in this by myself? No, I have days where I just want to go hide. I want to go on the mountain, grab a six-pack, and have some pizza. I don't want to be around anybody. But we have to demonstrate courage to face that. Increase your influence. You heard Todd talk about that a little bit. If you don't, you withhold information. We have a saying at Datron, our radio manufacturing company. We have a saying there that if you have information that you know someone needs, give it to them. Don't wait for them to ask. Don't wait for the email to come in. Don't wait for the request. Give it to them. If you need something, don't send an email. Go ask for it. I get so frustrated when I get two people. I have a cubicle there and a cubicle here, and they're sending emails between the two of them. And I'm going, can you just stand up and talk to each other? 30 emails later, when somebody hits the reply, he sends the whole thing, the whole string. Anybody have a 10-page string? Oh, Lord, stop it. Just stop it. Stand up and talk to someone. They're sitting right next to you. Or if they're downstairs, take the 30 steps to go downstairs and ask them and talk to them. People who don't want to do that use email for what? Anybody want to guess? CYA. I got to send you an email just to tell my boss I asked for it 3 weeks ago and I didn't get it. If you went down and asked for it face to face, I bet you get it. I bet you get it, right? Increase your influence. Live your transformation. That's really where you guys are starting to get. You've learned about servant leadership. You've learned about trust a little bit with Stephen yesterday. Now the question's going to be, what are you going to do with it? Where are you going to go? I've heard some great stories already in the last day and a half that we've been here. Great stories of people who have changed their mindset, are doing things differently. Charlie, who was here with Stephen the other day, sat next to someone in this room on the plane right out here. And the feedback I got from her is what makes me fly. Because we know we're getting to people. We know that people are understanding that there's a better way to do things. And that's pretty cool. Live your transformation. What are you going to do with it when you go forward? Servant leadership requires, you've heard a couple of these words already from Todd. Involvement. You've got to be involved with your people. You can't go sit in an office and send emails. You've got to be involved. You have to be committed to be involved. And that leads to relationships, doesn't it? You have relationships? Now, you've got some blanks in your workbook. You have a workbook. I've left these blank for you so you can fill them out. Because here's what I know. If I tell you something and you don't write it down, you're not going to remember 95% of what I tell you in 2 days. You're not going to remember it. So fill in the blanks. You have to be involved, you have to have a commitment, and you have to have a relationship. Okay, you want to have a little fun? You trust me? Okay, I got a little bit of trust. You guys want to extend some trust to me? Okay, so we're going to play a little game. What I'd like you to do is stand up your table, get a partner, and stand face to face with that partner. I want to see how involved you're going to be with this partner. Now, talk to that partner for a minute. See what you can find out about the person. See what you can observe from that person. All right, go ahead. I'm going to give you about 30 seconds. Okay, time's up. Time's up. Stop talking for a minute. All right, now turn around and put your backs to each other. Turn around, put your backs to each other. Now take a minute and change something about your look. Change something about your look. All right? Don't tell your partner. Don't peek. Change something about your look. You guys were talking really well. I want to see how much you observed and what you learned of that person. Everybody got something changed? Turn around and see if you can find anything different with your partner. All right. Now that you know the game, you should have been a little bit more involved and looked at your partner a little bit more. Turn around back to back again. Change something else about your appearance. Back to back, not facing each other, back to back. No sticking your badges on your forehead, like some of you did. That was kind of good, though. All right, now turn around and see if you can see a difference. All right, good. Watch on the other hand. Great. Cool. Okay, go ahead and sit down. Everybody look forward at me, at me. Can anybody in the room up front here tell me what color Peter's shirt is today? Orange. Bingo. You guys noticed the leader, didn't you? You probably could tell when he got here, what he puts in a coffee. You could tell that, right? What about your peers? Do you care that much about your peers as you do about Peter? You should. You should care even more. Here's what I know about relationships and trust. You build that by noticing the nonverbal signs of people that you deal with. People will communicate with you more in a nonverbal way than they will in a verbal way. And you have to get really good at reading those nonverbal signs. My wife knows when I'm upset. I have no idea when my wife's upset. Let alone any idea why she's upset. All I know is I have to say I'm sorry. And then we go down the path of, You don't even know why you're sorry. I said, no, I don't, but I know I did something wrong, so I'm sorry. Right? Anybody been down that conversation? All the time. So Todd, you promised me that report last Friday. Where is it? Didn't come to me. Tell me it wasn't going to be here. Didn't come to me and tell me, hey, I'll get it to you on Monday. I had something pop up. Right? Communicate with people. Involved. Be committed to doing that all the time. Not just to CYA, but to create a relationship with people. All right? What happens if you don't create a relationship? We enter the blame game. Everybody starts doing what? Point at everybody else. You ever been in a meeting where this side of the table and that side of the table, you know they work at the same company, you know you talked about that project 2 weeks ago, and yet there's two different interpretations of where they are in the project. That ever happened in your company? Drives me nuts. We test radios. I asked my manufacturing here, what's the first pass yield on our new testers we're putting in? He says, we're getting 8 out of 10. I asked my QA guy, I said, tell me what the first pass yield is. He says 100%. One guy says 80, the other guy says 100. My manufacturing engineer is giving me the first pass yield on the tester. My QA guy is giving me my first pass yield on the product. Two different things. I didn't ask for that, but what I found out was these guys measure things differently because they look at things differently. Do you think when things aren't going well and that yield drops to 50% that those two guys are going like this? They're going like this. But they work together really well because they've built a relationship. They've been involved, they're committed to each other, and they have a great relationship. So what happens on the farm? Right now, Clarice, it's all about her. Farmer Abel's doing me wrong. He doesn't even know why I'm not performing, doesn't know that the pigs are running the farm, doesn't know why I'm upset. So what she's doing, she's focused on herself. She doesn't see potential, she sees problems. We focus on problems instead of potential. She's also pointing a hoof and blaming other people on the farm. So what does that universal image look like when it's all about you? I love this graphic, because if you put yourself in the middle, it's all about you. And next to it, you got my stuff, then you got stuff about me, and then you got the stuff that you hate, and then someone on the outside, you've got the other person that you're trying to create a relationship with. Now, when someone shares a story with you and they talk about themselves first, they talk about all the stuff they do, they talk about everything that impacts their life, and they also tell them everything I hate, what do you think they're going to do in response? They're going to say, this leader doesn't care about me. I just heard a life story about him. All right? Are you in the center of this universe? Or do you put someone else at the center of the universe? If Clarice looked at doing everything for the sake of others, she'd focus on other people, see the potential in others. We have one more. Celebrate with others. When someone is having a bad day, anybody have employees that have bad days in your restaurants? You do, right? And that employee's performed pretty well in the past, right? Do you view them that day based on their performance or based on their potential? How do you view them? Do you look at them based on their day's performance, or you look at everything they've done great in your restaurant since they've been there? Right? We all have bad days. I have bad days. I have folks that will call Lisa, my assistant, and ask, is today's the day to put a $25,000 wreck in front of Art? She'll say, I don't think today's the day. Because they know that timing is everything, right? Timing is everything. They got to make sure that I'm in the right frame of mind to talk about that capital investment, to talk about it. What's it look like in the universe? You put others in the center. And then your family, and your friends, and your coworkers. And then you're on the outside of the universe, looking in. Now, some of you may put the family and trade it with the coworkers. Because I know, you know, we can't pick our family, right? We can pick our friends, but we can't pick our family. Family relationships are one of the toughest things to get along with long term in any organization I know of. I have three sisters. I have a relationship with one of them. And I think there's a lot of families just like that. Just like that. All right? When you put others at the center, you figure out who comes next, and then next, and your coworkers. I'm second on the wrist. Who was that, by the way? I'm second on the wrist. That's pretty cool. Now, the speed of trust. We're just going to do a little bit on the economic side. We passed out, you guys have, with the nine behaviors that we have come up with for servant leaders. It's not in your booklet. We gave you a separate piece of paper. What we've done is we've taken the trust behaviors that Stephen talked about yesterday and shown you where it integrates with the servant leadership behaviors to kind of give you a roadmap of how that influences the behaviors that your organization is looking for. So we gave you a little roadmap. Now, last time I was here, we talked about trust. Anybody remember the faces of trust graphic that was here last year? It had 12 different faces on it. Grumpy faces, happy faces, right? Kind of like happy faces. We like a happy face. These are the faces of trust that we have. These are all the faces. Now, I took out the grumpy faces. Who wants one? I took out the grumpy faces because you guys have already learned enough to be able to change your grumpy faces. Anybody? Anybody over here? These all have different faces on them. This one I love. That one I love, right? Ooh. What's your face every day as a leader? What is it? What's it look like? You winking with your tongue hung out? You smiling? People know how you're feeling? Oh, we're here, okay. Don't want to forget you guys. Who else? All right. Remember those faces. When you get the grumpy face, just squeeze the heck out of the face to get it back. Just squeeze the heck out of it, all right? So, what did you learn about trust yesterday when it came to economics? One last one, who wants it? All right. You trading in one face?
No, I fumbled it.
Oh, you fumbled it. Oh, okay, gotcha. What did we learn about trust yesterday with Stephen? Tax. You either have a tax or a dividend. A tax or a dividend. So when you have trust that's low, what happens? Speed goes down, cost goes up. So Clarice is having a hard time producing milk. She has to eat in the meadow to generate the milk. So she slows down her eating. She chews the same grass more because she's more upset. You ever seen anybody upset that just talks forever? Clarice is chewing forever. All right, she goes in, she produces 70% less milk. Farmer had to pay the same amount of money to put her in the farm, same amount of money to keep the meadow up to going, same amount of money to put the fence up. So that cost in that milk just went through the roof because she's not producing. Same thing happens in your restaurants. when someone's not producing, how many meals per hour can you run through your restaurant? When everyone's producing, how many meals can you generate? What I love about Luby's, we visited Luby's down in Houston. I'm from Disney, and at Disney, all they did was design lines, queues. They put people in every corner to make those lines look short. Anybody been to Disneyland or Walt Disney World? Stuck in a queue for an hour, 2 hours? What I liked about this restaurant, there was no queue. There was no line. You walked into a nice open spot. There wasn't change where you had to look like you were part of the cattle coming into the restaurant. I love that. You walk up, get your tray, get your utensils, and a nice linen napkin. And then we got to select some food. I loved it because I didn't have to stand in line. Those little things that make a difference in your restaurant. Now, when you look at me, you can figure, Art's going to get excited about not standing in line. Go figure, all right? But that's my Disney days. Trust. When trust goes up, what happens? Just the opposite. When Clarice is feeling great, she chews grass like crazy, which is going to turn into more grass she's going to be able to eat, which is going to turn into more milk, and now she's going to produce more milk, and Farmer Abel's going to be thrilled. Same acreage, same grass, same buildings, but now she's producing at 150%. So the cost has gone way down. What do you need to do to turn around trust and turn around this thing all about us? Invest time with your people. Now, we talked about this a little bit last year. Now, when we say invest time with your people, I don't mean go say hi to them and see how they're doing. I mean, take your calendar and write their name in your calendar. Are you committed to spend time with your people or not? Because the first thing I'll ask you is show me your calendar and I'll tell you if you're committed or not. And you want to spend time with your people. Cheryl Batchelder, Popeye's Chicken, she spends a day and a half every week one-on-ones with her people. Every week like clockwork. She runs a huge organization. I do the same thing. I spend time one-on-one with my people every week in the calendar. Not just walking by saying hi. We schedule it. Show them you care. How can you show people you care? Ask them how they're doing. For a female employee, the best thing you do is acknowledge that they changed their hairstyle until you like it. Anybody had that happen to them before? Yeah, I know you husbands have. Your wife's changed the hairstyle, and you don't see it for what, 3 weeks? You missed your chance. Acknowledge that something's different in their lives. They're smiling more. I notice you're happier. I just notice that you're smiling a lot more. Or I kind of notice you're down. What's going on? How can I help you? All right? Show them you care. Ask them about their lives. All right? That was the purpose of the exercise. Do you really care about who you're talking to recognize all the other stuff around him or her or just yourself? Commit to their growth and development. I would imagine you guys have a pretty big task here. You're dealing with a lot of millennials. Are you? You feel great about that? I heard one honest grunt back there. All right. They're different, aren't they? Have you figured them out? When you do, let me know. All right. But they're people. And I don't know if I gave you this tip last year or not, but do you have people that have kids that have tattoos on their arms and legs and all that kind of neat stuff? Ask them who their artist is. Don't moan and groan about it. Ask them who their artist is. And then sit back and watch that young person talk for 10 minutes. Because now you've shown an interest in their life. That really works well with your children when they get in that phase of putting ink on their body. Because they're not going to hear you scream and holler and tell them, you guys are fools, you don't understand it, blah, 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 blah. They're not going to listen to you. But if you ask them who their artist is, at least you know where they're going. You can go check them out, make sure it's safe, make sure it's FDA approved, make sure you can get information you can use, guys and gals and parents. It's a great way to make sure they're doing things safe. Same thing with your staff. Ask them questions about their life. Ask them questions about school. Ask them questions about who they like to give back in the community. You guys give back to the community where you do business. Ask them about their lives. And then pretend that you're interested. And you do that a couple times, and then you're really going to be interested, and it's going to be a great experience for you. But help them grow and develop. Find out what they want to do. Find out what they want to do. Behaviors, our first table talk. In your workbook, on page 8, I want you guys to take the next 10 minutes or so and discuss these three areas. Talk about the leader's behavior, the impact, and the assessment. And talk about these questions at your table. All right, everybody got it? Everybody have a workbook? Anybody need a workbook? All right, 10 minutes. Go ahead and turn around and talk with your folks at your table. A couple of conversations I listened on. Great conversations going on. When you talk about behaviors, it gets personal, doesn't it? And as leaders, we need to make sure that we don't make those discussions personal. We just don't make them personal. Don't put a name on them. That's for the performance reviews, right? That's for the performance reviews. That's where we give our individuals feedback. So you kind of see Clarice is not producing. She's upset with the pigs. Well, when Clarice goes out to the meadow, Harry's out there. Harry the horse. He sees what's going on with Clarice. He sees her chewing her cud on and on and on and on, muttering, complaining. And guess what? He starts to hear the complaining. He starts to feel the complaining. He starts to feel it. Now, we as leaders give off radio frequencies. Did you know that? You give off frequencies. When you walk into a room and you're having a tough day, you don't have to say a thing. I'll guarantee that 50% of your people will pick up that you're having a lousy day. They don't have to talk to you. They don't have to look at you. They just sense that something's not right. So when we're having a lousy day, our frequencies get passed on. When my frequency is not where it should be as a servant leader, my entire team knows it. They know it. Sometimes they have to tell me that. Most of the time I'll figure it out for myself. But sometimes they have to come and say, Art, you really need to rethink what you just did. All right? Because nobody wants to come talk to you right now because everybody is feeling the frequencies that you're putting off. Your body puts off frequencies and people receive them all the time. Keep that in mind. Harry's going, I feel her pain. So what does Harry do? Harry says, the pigs aren't working. Clarice isn't working. She's complaining. So what do you think Harry's going to do? He's going to start complaining. He's going, why should I work so hard if nobody else is working so hard? Why should I do that? So now it's starting to spread. Now it's starting to spread. And what we're talking about here is power base. And a horse is used for what in a farm? Anybody? Plowing your fields. You hook them up to a harness. Sometimes there's two horses, sometimes there's one horse. Sometimes they work as a team. Harry's working by himself. And he slows down. And he's not performing. So here's what Farmer Abel has to say about it. Confound it, Farmer Abel bellowed from behind the plow. I paid good money for you horses. I'm paying you a great salary. I calculated that you could plow 2 acres a day. 2 acres a day. And I'm getting half an acre a day. Farmer Abel, being keen on numbers, kept track in his bib and knows what the performance is going on. So what do you do with a horse that's not performing? Bring out the whip. Bring out the rope. So Farmer Abel brings out the whip. You think that worked? What do you think Harry did? Harry went, you know what? I wasn't working hard before, but I'm really not going to work hard on it for you now. You're jumping all over my tail, and I'm not going to do it for you. So now you got Harry upset. You got Clarice upset. You got the pigs consuming all the food. Your farm's not making any money. And Harry's saying, what's wrong with these animals? I paid great money for you. I'm paying you a great salary. How come you guys don't appreciate what I'm doing for you? You have a job. Get here on time. Leave on time. Go to your lunch on time. Take your break on time. Be thankful that you're working for me. How do you think that works? Anybody? Those folks you're going to have problems with. You're going to have problems with those folks. So it's starting to spread, and it spreads in your organization. So when you see the power come out, what does the power look like? Leaders want to hold on to everything. People in power want to hold on to everything. Take your hands and squeeze them real hard. Real hard. You feel the tension? You feel it? Let it go. You feel the relief? You feel how good it is? How do you think your people feel? How do you think they feel? If you let your folks go, they will do things that you couldn't dream that they could possibly do. But if you hold on to them and whip them, you're going to get half an acre instead of 2 acres out of them. They're going to get frustrated, and they're going to leave, and you're going to get frustrated. And nobody's going to be happy. Let them go. Stop holding on tight. When you have that situation, think about these balloons. And when you let them go, they fly. And every one of those balloons represents your employees. I'm your boss. You do what I tell you to do. I heard these words, if you can't do it, I'll find somebody who can. Anybody have that growing up in their work environment? I grew up in that power leadership. That was back when we didn't work 8 to 5. We worked 6 to 10, 6 days a week, because we were afraid of losing our job, because that's what was expected. And we gave up everything. I'm your boss. You do what I tell you to do. I'm here to help you. What can I do to help you get better? We heard earlier a story about you had someone in the kitchen that he couldn't stop talking. Did you have him in the right position? Who was that? Was that over here? Yeah. He wasn't in the right position, was he? You need to put him out there where he could talk with people. Are you putting people to work with their gifts, or are you just filling the slot? Now, sometimes as leaders, we just need to fill the slot, don't we? Let's not kid ourselves, right? We've got a line of people out the door. We have to get people on the line doing stuff. I have to fill that slot. I have to take care of business. When you do that, whoever you pull out to put on the line, tell that person, I need you here. This is what I need to do. I don't have time to explain why I'm reassigning you that day, but I'll come back when it's not as busy, and I'll explain it to you. I'll explain the Luby's way. I'll explain why we give out 2 shrimps. I'll explain why we cut steaks in half. And maybe some of the leadership should explain why that steak's been sitting there too long. I heard that comment too, right? I heard that one too, right? I'm here to help you. I'm here to put a smile on a child's face, to help a parent be happy. Cost you 2 shrimps. Who gives whatever you want to fill in? Probably the guy getting your reports, right? Wants to know why your profit's not where it should be? I'll guarantee if you tell the story of making a kid happy, it's not going to be because of the 2 shrimp. Because your business will be picking up, because that parent's going to do what? What's he going to do? They're going to come back, and they're going to tell their friends to come back, and they're going to tell families to come back, because you took the time to give them two shrimp. I'm here to help you. I'm here to put a smile on your face. Sometimes bosses just like to beat up on people, and everything's a battle. You got some employees like that where everything's a battle? I got some employees, I see you come down the hallway, I want to turn around and walk away, because they're going to suck the life right out of me. They'll suck it out of me, and I want to have some life when I go home. I don't want the life sucked out of me. But I have to be courageous and suck up my feelings and go, you know what? Maybe Lisa needs to talk to me today. Maybe I need to invest some time with her today to see what's going on. Sometimes my schedule changes because I have people issues to deal with. Drives Lisa crazy. But you know what? We care about people first. Who's at the top on the front page of the book you got handed out? Who's at the top of the book? What's at the top of that on the front page of your book? People. People, people, people. So a servant leader collaborates, helps. You're seen not necessarily as a friend, but as someone who wants to help you. Maybe your people see you as a leader that just tromps on people. And that's why they run away from you when you try to have a meeting. Nobody's available. Or do they see you as someone who's servicing and helping and going along with things? I love this photo. Because power leaders use people as tools. Anybody know a leader from your past? Because I know there isn't any leader in this room like this. Anybody in your past that you would put a hammer on top of that person's head? I got them. I didn't realize it was a hammer at the time because I just wanted to keep my job. But he's hammering away. Don't use them as tools. Are you more cared about having the power to win? Or are you going to let some other people win sometimes and take the power from you? How are you going to look at things? Are you so competitive as a leader that you have to win all the time? Or is it okay for you to go into a win-win situation? Not just, I win and you lose. Big difference. People are manipulated. They're puppets. They feel like every move is in a power model. Everything is watched. And they got strings attached in everything they do. Okay, now we haven't been involved here, so I'm going to have everybody stand up again at your table. I want to look, you guys look at everybody in your table, so focus on the center of your table. All right, so now I want you to give your best power leader pose. What's your best power leader pose? What does a power leader look like? If you were to cut that across in your pose, what would it be? Come on, you can do it. All you shy guys that don't want to put your hands up, come on. I know you pose in private, right? So let's pose. You know, so what's it look like? You guys, what is that the crossed arm look like? A power leader? We got a lot of scared people on this table. I mean, get the pose up. I mean, go. It's okay to put that arm up. What's your best? Yeah, there you go. Now, what's your best service pose? What's your pose as a servant leader? Oh, I got some hands like this. I got some laughing over here. What do you think? So, what's the pose? That's the service pose? That looks like a ducking pose from a power leader over here. What about over here? See? I guess put your hands out. Yeah, I'm here to help you. Right? Power. I love the hands on the hip. I just love it. Walk into a room like this, what does everybody in the room think? Uh-oh. I love people who sit back in their chair and go like this while you're talking. Are they listening to anything you have to say? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. The first thing you do when you walk into a meeting, you start cracking the whip. This is my meeting. I'm going to control it. I'm going to tell you what to say, when to say it, how to say it, and I'm going to tell us what we're going to do. Anybody have a problem? Good. Meeting is over. Right? So I'm going to give this table one more time. You got to do some power poses here. We're not going to let people sit down. You're going to have to deal with these people the rest of the afternoon because I'm leaving after I get done talking. Right? Come on. I want to see some power poses here. Come on. Come on. There we go. Now you're talking. Yeah. Power pose is that? Right there. Yeah. Right there. Yeah. All right. Good. See, I knew you guys could do it. You just got to let loose a little bit, right? Yeah. Yeah. Good. Okay. Everybody sit down. You think some of your people feel like their arms up over here? I'm being told to do this over here, but I know I should be doing this over here. I can't sell two shrimp. I gotta sell them a full dinner. I wanna do this, but I'm pulled over here. That's a great example, by the way. I didn't come prepared with the shrimp, but I gotta tell you, Todd, you set me up really good on that one. Yeah, no charge, cool. Really good. True power comes from serving and helping others. Such behavior, and underscore the word behavior, makes people respect you. When you have a pose like this as a leader, are people going to respect you? Probably. If you have one like this, and a face of disgust, you think they're going to respect you? Probably not. Power comes from serving and helping other people. That's an amazing, amazing concept. The whip makes your team not pull as a team. I don't care how hard Farmer Abel whipped his team, that team was not going to perform. Because they'd already seen what was going on in the pig pen. They already saw what was going on in the milk house. And now it was their turn. And I'm not going to work because nobody else is working. Nobody else is doing their job, so why should I do mine? Right? 70% of our employees in this country, and this is a new survey that just came out and reconfirmed again, 70% of our employees are disengaged. 70% are disengaged. Some of your leadership team over here was disengaged with the power pose. Until I came over and said, we're not going to let anybody else sit down until you do a power pose. And then they jumped in, right? So what did I do? I came over and made it fun. I didn't come over and hammer you guys and say, listen, you guys don't do a pose. You're not going to have lunch. So you guys decide. I encouraged. Come on, let's have some fun with it. Totally different approach. Totally different approach. Don't whip your team. How do you use your influence for the greater good of the team? For the greater good of the team. Not the greater good of you, but the greater good of the team. Team stands for together, everyone achieves more. Can you all read that with me? Together, everyone achieves more. Now, can you put a little oomph behind it? You really believe that together, this leadership team can do more together than you can do apart? Do you think you can learn from other people and your peers to help you solve issues in your own restaurants, in your own regions? One more time. Together, everyone achieves more. If you guys believe that as a team, Nothing's going to stop you. Nothing's going to stop it. Jim Valvano, North Carolina State, his team got into the Final Four. They shouldn't have been there. They were the Cinderella team. They were too short, not fast enough. You know what he did with his team? He got a plate of metal, about 5 inches thick, put it right in the center of the court. He asked every team member to go try and pick up that piece of metal and move it. No one could move it. He then asked his whole team to come around the plate and pick it up and move it around the court. That team could move that piece of hunk of metal anywhere in the court they wanted to. Anywhere they wanted to. They went into the Final Four with that belief that they could win the championship when everyone else was against them. Does your team believe they can do more together than they can apart? They can do more together. Help them understand that. And I hope you guys are on a great track to understand that. Teams need purpose. You guys have some great purposes. You guys are already know where you're going. You got the Luby's way, which is great. Goals, roles, processes. They need to know where they're going. They need to know what their goals are. They need to know the processes. What's on the front of your book again? Look at the front of your book. People, processes, and purpose. You got it covered. Do you believe what's on that book? Because if you do what's on that front cover of that book, you guys are going to have amazing results. You work together as a team. You're going to have successes. Todd went through a couple of KIPs where there were successes. Had the team leaders talk about how they got that. And then what do they need last? Celebrations. When you have a success, don't go, man, that's great, but you know, that was your job all along, so I'm glad you finally got there. Come back again tomorrow and do it again. Whoop-de-doo, oh boy, all right? But if you roll out the red carpet at Planet Hollywood for your performers with a sign that says, Luby's, welcome stars, are you kidding me? Somebody cares about the people who perform in this room. Somebody cares. We thought the red carpet was for us when we got here. What was neat was half the people in the line I knew. I stood there shaking hands, talking to people. I felt really welcome. I didn't walk on the red carpet because I don't feel like I'm a star with this team. You guys are recognizing stars in your team by rolling out the red carpet. Don't think that stuff is stupid. Don't think that. There isn't anything stupid when it comes to successes and celebrating those successes. Dress up in a funny looking hat, put some funny looking ears on, do something that makes you look like a fool as a leader, and thank someone for their performance. And watch them do it again. And watch them do it again. All right, back to the team table. Now I noticed some of the teams they were doing really well, and others were kind of going so-so. Let's get into this one again, because this is all about the team. All right? Page 12 in your workbook. I need some water. Go through those questions, discuss them at the table, and fill out what you learn. Your team experience, leadership behaviors that demotivate. And then talk about when there is no alignment among your team, what happens. All right, and again, this is not personal, but share some stories. Talk about what's going on in your restaurants and your organizations. I'll give you 10 minutes. Okay, so we've talked a little bit about the pigs. We've talked about the cow, Clarice. We've talked about Harry the horse. Talked about teamwork. You guys ready to go on chickens? This is probably the weirdest discussion of leadership you guys have ever had, right? We're going to go talk about chickens. And I want to encourage you, don't go back and call your folks chickens, okay? Please. All right. So what do you think has happened now? The cow's been infected. The horse has been infected. Who else is going to be infected? What do chickens do on a farm? They lay eggs. They lay eggs. Farmer Abel threw them food every morning, gave them what they needed. They were in a pen, but they got food every day, and all he expected was a little production. So anybody remember what Farmer Abel kept in his bib? What did he keep in his bib? A little pad. What's he write on the pad? How much production? What's going on, right? Now the production wasn't there. Hey, Farmer Abel's getting miffed. He reads an article in Advance Farmer Magazine. Gets an idea. And the idea out of the magazine is you need to cage your chickens up because they're wasting all this energy running around the pen outside. So why don't you put them in cages? So they're not wasting the energy in running around and they can concentrate on what? Laying eggs. Okay, so what does Farmer Abel do? He takes the advice from a magazine, doesn't test it. And what's a leader going to say when he comes across the latest and greatest leadership idea that comes out of a magazine? We're going to try it. Hogwash. Hogwash. He's going to try it. He's going to put chickens in cages. So what's he do? He puts them in cages. Juanita doesn't like her new environment. Juanita's one of these chickens that likes to be out and runs around a lot. So guess what happens? Juanita starts talking to the other chickens. And how many eggs do you think they're producing every day? Less. Farmer can't figure it out. So he talks to another farmer, and he says, you need to go a step further. He says, you need to enclose them in the dark. Because in the dark, they won't see the light. They won't be worried about everything going on in the world. And you'll keep them in the dark, and they'll produce more. Sound familiar? That's part of my power leadership build up. Keep them in the dark. Don't tell them what's going on in your organization, and they'll produce just as much as she did. Hogwash. I love that term. That's not in the book, by the way. How about we're going to add it somewhere. Hogwash. So he puts them in a dark room. And what do you think happens? Less production. But he left a little corner in the roof that showed a little light. And Juanita saw that light and said, there is a future here. Someday, Farmer Abel is going to come to his senses and going to do the right thing for us. Someday, my leader in my company is going to realize what we need to have to be productive, and they're going to give it to me. Someday, my supervisor is going to understand. They see the light in the corner of the building, and they keep hope. They love working for an organization. They love this farm. The animals love this farm. They got hope that Farmer Abel is going to get it together. In their pig pen, in their cage, in the darkness. Tell people what's going on in your organization. Share with them the results that you're having. At Datron, my team sees exactly the same information I get. The same financials, the same notes, the same everything. Because I know my folks will perform better if they understand more about the business than they do if I keep that from them. That they'll get better at it. They have a ray of hope. And they'll do things differently. There's a lot of hope in that 70% of unengaged employees. They're waiting for some leaders in this country to stand up and do the right thing and serve them and help them and care about them. They keep looking at this light every day and they hope that the light gets bigger, just like Juanita. When you coop up a dream, productivity becomes a nightmare. When my daughter went to work for us at Datron, she became the receptionist out of school, out of high school. And I thought, well, we'll start her receptionist, then we'll put her in HR. She'll learn some stuff about the business. Then she'll want to become a manager. Then maybe someday she'll want to jump in and run the company. Do you think my dream happened? I never asked her what her dream was. When I did, at 19 years old, you know what her dream was? She said, I want to make enough money so I can go to concerts. That was it. She didn't have no, I don't want to get promoted. Just pay me enough so I can go to concerts with my friends. That's what life was about for her at 19 years old. You got people taking their shirts off and walking out. My guess is that's what they like that. Why they do it, I don't know. Can you convince them to keep a Luby shirt on until they get in the car and drive off the property? I think you probably could, right? Wait, maybe buy his car with his paycheck. Maybe that could do it, you know? But her dream was nowhere close to mine. What I've learned about the young people around us is they're full of creativity. They're full of desire. They're full of hope. And they're looking for someone to care about them and help them see what their dream is. At 19, she didn't have a dream. My job at when she was 19 was to help her find her dream, not tell her what I thought it was, because she wasn't going to listen to me. So when you coop up that dream, when you keep that dishwasher in the kitchen talking to the dishpans, you either got to send him to a psychiatrist or put him out front talking to people. Because that's what he's good at, and that's what he wants to do today. May not be what he wants to do 5 years from now, but today, that's what they want to do. Find out from your people, your young kids. If they want to make enough money to go to concerts, help them do that. Pay them a good wage. Give them a little number of hours if there's a special concert coming up in your area and they want to go and they need a little extra money, give them a few more hours. And if you do that, guess what they're going to do? They're going to put their shirt on and wear it all the way to the car. Guaranteed. Because you help them meet one of their dreams today. One of my senior leaders about 8 years ago came to me and said, all right, I need to retire, I'm getting old. I said, well, Fred, you can't go yet, we're not done. And he says, I have a dream. He says, I want to make a certain amount of money before I retire in 1 year. And he was on a commission plan. So I sat down with him over 3 months. We developed a commission plan to help him meet his goal if he hit a certain level. That was $200 million. That year, we booked over $200 million worth of new business because I helped him meet his goal. He's retired 3 times. He keeps coming back to help us. And what he tells me, he says, Art, I will do anything for you and Lori because you made an incredible difference in me and my family's life. I found out last year he has a nickname in his family. He's called the Godfather. Because when people need help in his family, guess who they go to? They go see Fred. And now he can help them because I helped them reach his dream. You can do it with your younger generation. You can do it with your older generation. Find out what their dreams are and help them get them. Sometimes those dreams take them somewhere else. But in a servant-led organization, we celebrate people moving on to a position that gets them to the next level of their career. Now, servant leadership doesn't say that we just serve the people and measure their success based on inside our building. We hire a lot of young kids that have aspirations that want to go somewhere someday. Help them get there. Do something along the way to help them get there. And watch how the attitude changes. Servant leaders meet people where they are. I love this next graphic. Some of your employees just focus on the light. They're visionaries. They're visionaries, and you have to give them that. And they'll perform. Some just need to roam around in the pen. They need flexibility. They don't have a DNA that they can stay in a certain box in a certain area for 8 hours a day. That's not in their DNA. Find out what's in their DNA. Give them the flexibility. Some just need to be caged. And that means that some people, they like to have rules. Tell me what I do, how I do it, and I will do it very, very well. But don't expect me to go see a situation and go take care of it, because I'm a rules person. I like the rules, and I'm never going to go out of that box. Those people are priceless in your organization, folks. They're priceless because you're going to rely on them to do things the same way all the time. You know they're going to be there. Don't discount them. Don't think everybody's going to go become a visionary, because it won't happen. Some people just need to be listened to. They need to feel like they're being listened to. I'll tell you, the younger generation today just needs to feel listened. And listen to understand them. Not just say, yeah, I heard what you said. Did you feel what they said? When they have a crisis in their life and they want to go to that concert and they can't figure out a way to do it, do we say, who gives a rat's behind? You got to be at work. Or do we help them find a way to get it done? That's how you care about your folks and do things a little bit different. Is that difficult? Oh man, it is tough. I was raised in an 8-to-5 environment. You're at your desk 5 minutes to 8 and you leave at 5 minutes after 5. You take 1 hour for lunch. In today's environment, I get more out of my son, who's in graduate school right now, I get more out of my son when he works out of an office on the campus. He says, Dad, I don't need to be in the office to work. He said, oh, by the way, I convinced a professor who's not going to be here for another 6 months. He lets me use his office. I have a key to his office. So he goes from his class to his office, and he's working like that. He doesn't have to get in the car and drive up the Vista, take 45 minutes to an hour to drive one way. He's working right away, answering emails. Now, you guys have a tough job. You can't have your servers go, remote, right? So you got to figure out some things. But I would guess to say you have some very successful remote people in your organization already who are using technology very, very well. You meet people where they are. You figure out what their gifts are. You figure out what's in their DNA. You help them move from the kitchen to the hostess station. And guess what? They're happy campers, and they produce. And they love you for it because you took the time to care. So when you serve others, you put others above yourself. You're number two. But here's the caution I will tell you. Don't go overboard with that. Do not go overboard. Because you can serve people and put so much time into other people, you forget about your own family. You forget about yourself. You forget about those who care about you. When I bought Datron World in 2004, I put everything I had into that company. Every second of every day, 7 days a week. It bought me a trip to the hospital for 30 days in 2014. I almost went home. I had an infection that started 6 months earlier. Doctor said, you've had this in your body for 6 months, and nobody cared to find out about it because I carried an extra weight. Just lose some weight and you'll be okay. It was hidden for 6 months. I also found out I had sleep apnea. I went in on a Monday. I was supposed to be hosting a conference, Servant Leadership Conference in San Diego. Called Robin, our president, that afternoon from emergency, where I thought I'd get a magic pill to make me feel better. And they checked me into the hospital. Told Robin, I'm not going to make it. I'm not going to make it to the conference. I lost consciousness that night and woke up Thursday morning. Monday night to Thursday morning. Thursday morning, I got up like a good leader, woke up, Lori by my side, tubes hanging out of my arms, out of my nose, and I said, give me my clothes. Where do I need to go? I need to go to the conference. She said, honey, the conference ended yesterday. I said, no, it didn't. We came in Monday. It's going today, Tuesday and Wednesday. We got to get down there. She said, honey, you've been asleep for almost 3 days. I can't imagine what I put her through in those 3 days. I can't get it back, but I can make sure I don't put her through that again. Don't put your loved ones through that because you're so engrossed in one area of your life. Don't do it because you can't get it back. You can't get it back. All right, we're gonna do one quick one here, and then we're gonna break for lunch. But before that, do that, I just wanna share with you, because once you get done with that at noon, you will break for lunch. But before you get into that, I think I have the next one. The Luby's Way. So let me share with you a story. In Houston, Lisa and I decide to go out to dinner, and where do we go? Luby's. I mean, we're working with the team, let's go to Luby's. Walk in, no line, get the tray, get some food. Lisa gets something that they put gravy on. Guy from behind the counter says, would you like gravy? She says, yeah, sure. He says, what kind? Lisa says, we have a choice. This young man said, oh, we have all kinds of choices in life. But today, this is what we have in gravy. I love Mike, was his name. We haven't stopped talking about Mike because he reminded us that we have choices in life. And today, you just have to make a choice about your gravy. So we got our food, we sat down, we talked to the other folks that were helping out at the table, asked them if they liked their jobs. We got smiles. But this little thing was on the table. The Luby's Way. And we had spent the morning talking about how do we get the young people excited in our organization. Have you read this lately? You guys buy food from local farmers. I don't know if it's organic or not. Don't know. Don't care. But you're giving money back to farmers. Farmer Abel loves that, by the way. You're giving back to farmers. Fresh food every day. You trim your own beef. It's your own recipes. And you make them fresh every day. I read that and said, I got to take a picture because I got to take it back to the team. The Luby's Way. Now, get excited about this because this is how you get these young people excited about what you do. And on top of that, you give back to the communities you do business in. You buy from farmers, fresh food. You trim your own beef. It's your own recipes. It's fresh made every day. And we also give back to our communities. Wow! Are you kidding me? You guys should be talking about that every day to your young folks and making sure they understand what you do, why you do it, and how long you've been doing it. Think about that as you go do this last exercise. Look on page, I think it's page 16. Numbers-driven organizations, business results, and achieving results should be guided by the organization's mission, purpose, values, intention, and aspires. Talk about those two things. And remember what Stephen said yesterday. One of the best quotes that we've ever come up with at SLI is that how you get those results is more important than the results themselves. You can be successful. You can blow out the market. You can make all kinds of money. But are you going to be around here in 5 years from now? Or are you going to go to the graveyard with the other companies that just did things the wrong way to make money, and guess what? They're no longer here. Care about how you do things. And you already do because you got the Luby's Way. All right, finish up the exercise, and then we're going to break for lunch, right, Todd? Yep, and we're back at 1 o'clock, and we come back here in the room at 1 o'clock. All right. Great session, guys. Finish this one last exercise up.